George and Becky, I warned them that I would be the unnatural addition to this symposium talking about an artificial selection experiment, but they nonetheless forced me to participate. All of this was done in collaboration with Tricia Radetich, who was a middle school teacher, now a high school teacher, and before that she was a PhD and postdoc and left it to do middle school teaching. Okay, so. I'll just skip over this outline. Okay, so we know that in teaching evolution at most levels, it's traditionally kind of text-based. You go through definitions and such. You have historical reviews of published results and such. There are also various kinds of simulations and active learning exercises you can use. We probably all participated in finding the red and green toothpicks out in the grass and so forth. There's caminocules and such. And many of these are hosted or have been turned into kind of formal lesson plans that are hosted at ENSI, which is at the Evolution and Nature Sciences Institute that has been around for a long time and is hosted at the University of Indiana. There are also nowadays these fancier computer modeling simulations that are gaining traction, I think. A lot of people are starting to use those. But in general, evolution doesn't really lend itself to inquiry in the classroom. As we all know from Darwin, it takes a relatively long time. And if you're using live organisms, there are, you know, animal protocols, expense, and so forth and so on. So one of the things I realized a few years ago is that specimens in the form of digital images are available for lots of evolutionary studies. They can be pictures of fish fins or something like that. They can be pictures of bird wings or videos. They can be histological sections from CT scans or brains or limb. Whatever, and there's lots and lots of that material out there, but it isn't routinely made available, or at least hasn't been. Now, as you know, many funding agencies and journals are requiring raw data, or in many cases, the raw data are digital images. So I think we're entering an era where much more of this information can be made available, and many times, those digital images haven't been fully mined for information. So it means there's actually opportunity for students to do new things that actually weren't done when the original papers were published and then people go on to other things. All right. So this is a lesson plan that we originally developed for middle school, but it's easily scaled up to college and it's hosted there at ENSI. There is a publication that supports it. This is essentially the middle school lesson plan journal of the National Science Teachers Association. And we got 5 peer reviews of this, and they were interesting. Three of them had a common theme. One of them said the students might come away thinking that evolution could be demonstrated in the lab by many results. Okay. This perpetuates the misconception that evolution occurs across a few generations. As you know, we have many, many examples now of rapid evolution in the wild. It might promote a misconception that evolution occurs from one generation to the next. Yeah, that's what I said. So these were fairly easy to rebut in the response to the reviewers, and it just in fact made the point why we need to publish this kind of thing. You know. This lesson plan affords students opportunities to design and perform their own investigations. They can develop hypotheses, as I'll tell you in a minute. They can collect and analyze real data. They can sort of participate in real science with the research lab, and they can participate in crowdsourcing the results of their investigations. So it also helps dispel some of these common misconceptions. So for example, evolution indeed can occur rapidly. It's very easy to observe changes in behavior morphology in fewer than 10 generations in the wild and in the lab. It is amenable to direct experimental investigation, not only historical science. And it's not just a theory in the sense that if students can directly observe evolutionary changes in materials themselves, it's kind of hard to deny that. So this is a book Michael Rose and I edited a few years ago. It just kind of goes through the different types of selection experiments and experimental evolution. Some of them are done in the wild. The one I'm talking about is down here. So this end of the spectrum where you're directly choosing on a particular phenotype and then observing changes. So the basic idea of this selection experiment, I'll tell you a little bit more about. I like to think it's pretty simple. You can explain to your students, your mom can understand it. You know, you're getting a bunch of mice, you're letting them run on wheels, you're picking the high runners and breeders and so forth and so on. We think that the phenotype we study, I'll tell you a bit more about in a minute, but it's how much they're running voluntary on fields, is relevant to evolution in the wild, related to something like daily movement distance or range size. It involves lots of subordinate traits in the way of behavior, motivation, physiology, muscle function, lumbar function, and of course skeletal function. And so you can make lots of ties in that direction and get as functional as you want. It's also relevant to human health, as you know, physical activity plays a major role in energy balance in both physical and mental health, both in a preventive and a treatment kind of fashion. So I think there's many different hooks you can use to get your students interested. We publish a lot of papers on these. They're all on my website, and lots of known phenotypic differences in the brain and the heart, et cetera, et cetera. So you can give the students as much of that background as you choose. So we started with 224 mice from an outbred strain, random mated them for a couple of generations, put them up in eight lines, and then four of these are bred for high running, four are non-selected controls for random genetic drift. The selection criterion is how much they run on days 5 and 6 of exposure to these rat-sized wheels, so the mice choose how much they run. The computer records the data every minute, and then we pick based on running on days 5 and 6. This shows the experiment worked. This is the first 50 generations. We're now at 81 up here, but I can update the graph. And you can see it worked. They reached the selection limit. Those are the females. The males always run less, but the fold difference is about threefold in both sexes. So it's a pretty dramatic thing. The students can understand, you know, evolution occurred. So what we do is we make available lots and lots of photographs of, in this case, femurs, but we can give them lots of other things. They're all hosted on the web. And there, with the lesson plan, there are videos of me giving little talks. There are PowerPoints for the teachers. And depending on where in the curriculum, in middle school, high school, whatever you're doing, you may want to emphasize various aspects of this. The lesson plan on the web talks about how it meets the NGSS and the California standards and all that kind of stuff. Okay, so this is from the teacher PowerPoint. This was originally for a middle school kind of thing where you can talk to the students about what are animals that are good runners like. They can come up with examples. You can often link to YouTube videos of various running animals. There's amazing resources out there. You can then sort of get them to think about what the legs of animals that are good runners might be like, and then go a little further in question and say, how might this show up in, say, the femur bone, big bone in your hind limb. So then, they can go through all the steps of the scientific method. They can make some observations about what good running animals are like. They have questions about how would the legs of mice have been bred for that behavior different. They can come up with hypotheses that are fairly obvious, and then they can try to come up with predictions more specifically about the femurs of these animals or other bones. So there are many measurement options. You can just, we try to make this accessible, so not all schools have computers. Many schools have policies against cell phones and computers and such. So you can just print the photos out and have them measured with a ruler. They, of course, have a scale bar. You can just put it up on your computer screen and measure it directly there with a ruler. The teacher I worked with actually uses ImageJ with her middle schooler. She thinks that's cool. I don't even do that with college students. I'll spend the whole discussion section trying to teach them about ImageJ, but she does it. And then what we like to do, at least at the college level, is to create a Google form. So we have 100 students in evolution. Each student gets assigned 10 measurements, so individual photos, and every bone is measured twice, so we look at repeatability and such. And they enter in, their student ID, and it all gets time stamps, and we should turn it on time, they make the measurements and so forth. That's an example of a form. You can customize it any way you want. And of course, this is free, right? The students don't need to call a cell or office or anything like that. And we give the directions for how to do this in the lesson plan. So these are 1,000 measurements that were crowdsourced from, 100 students, 110 measurements each kind of thing. So there are many different questions then you can address once you have these data. So the way we usually run this is they've already had a lecture on quantitative genetics, selection experiments, something about the mice as an example of a selection experiment. And so then the TA, typically in the discussion section, will talk to them about, okay, we've got the opportunity to look at these mouse bones. What do you think would be interesting to measure? The students come up with different ideas. And then at the end of the day, literally, when all 5 discussion sections are finished, the TA and I make a sort of some executive decisions about what will we actually measure, because you can't measure everything, so you come up with three or four or five things to get assigned to students. And then they go away to make the measurements, and then we sort of sit down with that spreadsheet, we kind of blitz the data, we make every graph and t-test and regression you can think of, so that you can anticipate the things they might ask you in discussion and just kind of pop up the graph for them. So I've taught them about repeatability, data quality, reproducibility, so they might ask, well, you know, measurement one versus measurement two, are there discrepancies? If so, what do? Throw one out, throw both out, go back and remeasure, that sort of thing. They may be interested in whether males and females differ. They'll know right away that males are larger in body size and that might have some effects, you know, so they can get those data. What do you need to make a bar graph, a histogram, what have you? Then, of course, they can get to the selected versus control lines. They might think this highlighted lines would have longer legs, but that immediately leads to questions about, you know, what about body size? And they've had lectures on allometry and scaling before this, so hopefully some of the students think about that. So if you're interested in body size, what do? You calculate a ratio of leg length to body length, or do you make a scatter plot, or what have you? And depending on the level of your students, they can actually do regressions, or they can just, you know, eyeball the data, what have you. And what we tend to do, because we found it sort of leads to less confusion and kind of cleaner write-ups on this, is we will, again, at the end of the day, after the five discussion sections have said, well, let's look at this graph or analyze this or that, we will kind of come up with a sort of cherry pick the top three that seem to be the most interesting to tell the clearest story. We will make the graphs, we will do the stats, we'll give them kind of a one-page result section so they don't get all messed up on that. Then they go away and maybe we have them write an intro, a methods, a conclusion, that kind of thing. Or sometimes we have them do sort of a survey. So anyway, the point about this, I guess, in the end, is that this is a really easily scalable exercise. In middle school, you're probably going to do one sex, one selected line, one control line. In college, you're going to do all eight lines, talk about replication, genetic drift, and all that kind of stuff. So go ahead and, you know, run with it. If you have any interest in this, feel free to contact me. And we also have at UCR an institute where we host various different kinds of lesson plans for the